Good morning and happy Sabbath. Today is Mother's Day Sabbath. And praise the Lord and for giving us mothers. By definition, mother is a female parent. Your mother is the woman who gave birth to you. But who are really considered mothers? A mother is anyone who delivers or provide care to the world, or anyone who considers herself one. We are simply saying that mother is not just a definition, rather it's a principle. At this time of the year, we amplify mother's love. Mother's love is a kind of love that every human being needs. We cannot outgrow the need for it, although we sadly forget how much we need it. But mother's love is so strong that we can fall into it, especially when we are stressed, we are stretched, we are uncertain, and feeling like we are having difficulty to handle what's happening in our lives. Again, praise the Lord for our mothers. For our call to worship, shall we open our Bible in Exodus 20:12? If you can imagine, when the Lord gave the Ten Commandments, there are two tablets. One is 1 to 4, and this is the other half is 5 to 10. The very top one is, this is what it says. I'm taking this from King James Version, and it says, honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord your God is giving you. May the Lord bless us as we contemplate on this verse. Help us to respect and honor our mother as the Lord command.
So my brother, if the Let us pray. Our Father God in heaven, we give you all the glory and honor. We thank you for your loving kindness, mercy and compassion are new every morning, and your love towards us is everlasting. We thank you, O Lord, for your promise that if we give ourselves to you and accept you as our Savior, then sinful as our life may have been for his sake, we are accounted righteous Christ's character, and we are acceptable before God, just as if we have not sinned. What a wonderful God we serve. We come to you now, Father, in humility with a heart that is full of repentance. We confess our sins to you and we receive your forgiveness and cleaning from all our unrighteousness. Lord, this Sabbath is women's ministry. We ask, Lord, to bless all women, and I pray that this ministry is Christ-centered, helping other women to come to Christ and to grow in Christ. Encourage women to understand the gospel, respond the gospel, and apply the gospel to every aspect of life, and that happened when women engage through his word. Father God, today we also honor, celebrate, and reflect on mothers. We thank you for the example of unconditional love that they share with us each and every day. Thank you, all mothers who played with us, taught us, nurtured us, listened to us, tried to understand us, and who pray for us. May we remember our mothers' beauty and loveliness on this special day. Lord, we lift up those who need and seek the deliverance, to those battling physical sickness such as cancer, disease, virus caused by this COVID-19 that are sweeping around the globe. Once again, Lord, we pray for the safety of those who are frontliners, families, friends, neighbors. Give them healing to those who are infected, and courage and strength. In time like this, Lord, remind us to be good, cheers, because you have overcome this world, and we have nothing to fear as your children. In time like this, we can rest assured that even the things that destroy our temporal body can never depart us for that eternal life with you, O Lord. Dear God, thank you that one day sickness, suffering, fear, heartaches, and death will over, that one day Jesus will come and we live with him forever and ever. Help us, Lord, that we can look forward for that blessed hope. Thank you, Lord, for hearing and answering our prayer. In Jesus we pray. Amen.
Putting God first can be difficult. What can we learn from Saul, who refused to put God first? Saul stood head and shoulders above other men and became the first king of Israel when he was 30 years old. Saul reigned for 42 years, and during this time, he did many things right. However, he constantly refused to follow God's instructions entirely, finding a different path, trying to improve on what God had said. Some of us are tempted to rationalize our own desires, providing internal explanations to why we follow our own plan when it comes to tithe and offerings. Putting God first was not easy for Saul, and it certainly is not easy for us. Saul continued this path until God rejected him as king. God stepped back from protecting Saul to the point that an evil spirit tormented him. God grants us the free will to reject him and his plans, but by so doing, we forfeit his blessings. Saul turned evil and spent much of his energy and resources pursuing his loyal servant David. Even while trying to return to God later in life, he used the very methods forbidden by God, turning to necromancers. But God does not speak through spiritualism. By the way, no new revelation may be received if there is a neglect of what has already been revealed by God's prophets. When we refuse to put God first in the small things, eventually we will also go too far. Perhaps you have not been putting God first in your tithe and promise, or another area in your life. God is merciful, and if you confess it, He will always forgive you immediately. You can start putting Him first in your life today. Saul refused to put God first. The consequences were terrible for him and the people around him. God's love compels us to put His kingdom first, while Saul's example is a warning for us today. As we return our tithe and promise, we are challenged to put God first.
Today, people honor their mothers and tell how wonderful and special she is. I have here several things with me to show you and tell you about my mom. Eggs! My mom always wants me to eat a well-rounded breakfast. Now, my idea of a well-rounded breakfast is my Dutch Champorado. But my mom does not always agree all the time. My mom wants me to eat something like egg and rice and some fruits. And a cup of milk to drink. Why? Because my mom loves me and she wants me to grow up to be strong and healthy. Dishwashing detergent. I guess my mom never heard about child labor laws. She has the idea that every member of the family should chip in and help with the chores. My siblings and I have special jobs to do, and we are expected to do them without being told. Why? Because my mom loves us and she wants us to learn that a happy family is one where everyone works together.
Books. Sometimes after school, I like to play with my iPad or watch cartoons on TV. But my mom will always ask me first if I already did my homework. Why? Because my mom loves me and she knows that a good education is one of the best things she could give me.
Microphone. My mom loves to sing, and most of the time the song she sings is for the church. My mom encourages us, my siblings and I, to do the same. Because for her, singing is another way to connect with Jesus like praying. My mom said that we will always find comfort in singing, especially when we are sad or we are down. She also said that singing is like sharing a sermon or a message to the other people about God's presence in our lives and His love for us.
Bible. My mom bought this beautiful Bible when she was still young. This Bible is very special for us because it becomes part of our family worship. And my job most of the time is to find a verse from this Bible for us to memorize every night. What's more special about this Bible is that my mom had inserted tiny little notes like this. She liked these verses when she was young. And for me, it's a beautiful keepsake to remember my mom. Some of us may not have our moms anymore, but do believe that your mom loved you and that she wanted what was best for you.
1 verse 8 says, "My son, hear the instruction of your father, and do not forsake the teachings of your mother." As you think for a nice gift to honor your mom this Mother's Day, I want to challenge each one of you to find anything around in your house that will tell you about your mom. Those tiny little things will give you so many details about her, and they are worth remembering. This is all for now. Happy Sabbath and happy Mother's Day to all mommies. Bye.
Our scripture reading this Sabbath is found in the book of Galatians, chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law." May God bless the reading of His Word.
The Lord bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord
The message for us today will be delivered by an ever-ready woman of God who makes time to be available in service to God. Although she's a very busy lady, she did not hesitate to accept our invitation to speak. The lady of the hour is Sister Meredith Gudanin. She was born into the Willowdale Church family and has been involved in the Finance Committee, Church Board, children and youth ministries throughout her membership there. Currently, she serves as Adventist Education Leader. Meredith attended the Crawford Adventist Academy, attained an honors Bachelor of Business Administration from the Wilfrid Laurier University, and is a CFA charter holder. Meredith founded the former Crawford Mentorship Program out of her passion for mentorship. Her professional experience as director at RBC Capital Markets allows her to practice mentoring and coaching with the teams that she leads. Meredith thanks God for her greatest accomplishments in her marriage of 15 years to Alden, and in their children, Sophia, Kingston, and Quincy. Today, God will talk to us through the experiences of Sister Meredith as a mother, and she will be talking about the various roles of a mother through the lens of the fruit of the Spirit. Let us now give our undivided attention to the Word of God through Sister Meredith Gudanin.
The modern mother wears many hats. She juggles many roles. For me, I have a role of wife, mother of three kids, and caregiving daughter to my elderly parents who live with my family. I also work full-time as a bank executive, and I volunteer at church and in the community. As mothers, as women, God has blessed us with these various roles and given us the gifts of compassion and emotional intelligence to nurture those around us. He provides us with the strength and support to be successful in these roles. Let's look at the various roles through the lens of Galatians 5, 22 to 23. The fruit of the Spirit. But first, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, please bless us. Be with us now. Speak through me. May you bless us all through this message. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Recite the fruit of the Spirit with me. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Let's look at each fruit in reverse order from the perspective of a mother and her various roles in life. Most of what I do in my life is driven by my motivation to take care of my family, to be the best I can be, to benefit those who depend on me, my children, my husband, my parents, and my extended family. This all starts with physical health. So I need to practice the fruit of the Spirit of self-control or self-discipline to make myself exercise and eat well. I try to work out multiple times a week. It takes discipline and mind over matter. Some days I don't feel like it. I'm tired, I'm hungry, but then I tell myself it's only 45 minutes out of 24 hours of my day. I can waste that time scrolling on my phone, or I can gain health by sweating and conditioning my body. It's been hard during the pandemic with the gym closures. The latest lockdown a few weeks ago made me depressed and I didn't want to work out. And I was so down about another lockdown, canceling spring break travel plans, and physical schools were canceled again. So then I just ate and ate and ate. I was really down, but God blessed me with some accountability partners like my sister and my husband which gave me the motivation to start working out again. It also takes an abundance of self-control to not eat my feelings or my fridge. I find controlling what, when, and how much I eat is way more challenging than making myself work out regularly. How do I manage? Be practical. Don't buy the sweets and the treats and things that will tempt you. You can't eat if it's not in your cupboard. And substitute. Make healthy choices. If I want a snack and I want a cookie, I'll try to use self-control and make a protein shake instead. Or if the kids are eating chips, I'll grab a couple and then I'll walk away. Lead yourself out of temptation. Just like any gift or skill, we need to practice the skill of discipline and the gift of self-control for them to become natural to us. Start small. Set goals. Make a plan. Tell yourself, I will exercise tomorrow at X time. Find a workout on YouTube. Find the place in your home where you'll do the workout. And get your tools ready. Your mat, your weights, your water bottle, your towel. Or if walking is your type of exercise, do that. Get your music playlist ready. Then get your head in the game. Make your mind up that that is exactly what you're going to do. Then stick to it. The rest of your day will revolve around that 30 to 45 minutes that you've set aside to work out. Get that first one out of the way and then pat yourself on the back and tell yourself, see, I can do it. And then do it again. Just set the goals and don't let anything move it off your calendar. The same goes for healthy eating. Portion control. Meal plan and prepare. Cut the sugar intake. Eat lots of green veggies. Self-control will get you to your goals. What does the Bible say about self-control and discipline? I discipline my body like an athlete, training it to do what it should. For God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. Be strong and do not give up, for your work will be rewarded. Let's practice self-control and discipline to exercise and eat well so our bodies will be strong and healthy. Physical health is the start of being our best selves so we can live long and take care of everyone who depend on us. For all the mothers and women out there who have so much going on in their lives, so many roles to play, the fruit of the spirit of gentleness is self-care. Gentleness for yourself. Practicing the fruit of self-control in order to exercise and eat well, speak to the physical wellness to keep our bodies strong and healthy. Practicing the fruit of gentleness on yourself and self-care speak to the mental wellness to keep our minds and emotions strong and healthy. What is self-care? Doing something for yourself that builds you up inside or out. For yourself, not for others, not your kids, not your spouse or partner, not your work, not for your home. Here are some wonderful ways a woman can find rest and refreshment. Self-care can be going for a walk and spending time in nature. It can be taking a hot bath or getting a massage. Self-care can be spending time alone, digging into God's word, and in prayer, or journaling, reading a book, watching a show, taking a nap, doing a hobby. A couple of mine lately with the lockdown is doing jigsaw puzzles, exercising, and even playing the piano after several decades. But self-care is not doing laundry or dishes or cleaning the bathroom. While doing something we enjoy for ourselves, we can recharge, get refreshed, and re-enter the life of service we do for everyone else, like child care, elderly parent care, home care, work. Think of it like the Sabbath, a break from the week's work to rest and get refreshed, so that when the week starts again, you are recharged and re-energized. Self-care for an hour a day is not unreasonable when you spend the rest of your waking hours doing things for everyone else. Eleanor Brown says, when you take time to replenish your spirit, it allows you to serve others from the overflow. You cannot serve from an empty vessel. Let me introduce you to the term mental load. It is a term for the invisible labor involved in managing a household and family, which typically falls on a woman's shoulder. Also sometimes referred to as worry work or cognitive labor, the mental load is about not the physical tasks, but rather the overseeing of those tasks. It's being the one in charge of having the never-ending list of to-do items constantly running through your head, remembering what needs to get done and when, delegating all those tasks to respective family members, and making sure they actually get done. Even though now in modern times, men are contributing more to the care of children and the household, women continue to hold the responsibility for making sure housework gets done. Women may be doing less loads of laundry, but she ensures that the detergent doesn't run out, that all of the dirty clothes gets washed, and there are always clean towels, and that the kids have clean socks. Many women still hold the mental burden of the household, even if others share in the physical work. And that mental burden takes a toll. Our roles at work, as parents, as spouse, as cooks and cleaners, these roles have physical and visible labor involved, so people see and can respect the work that we do. But the mental load that women have is invisible labor, and because it is not seen, how often is this work overlooked, taken for granted, and most importantly, underappreciated? Which is why Mother's Day is so important. So husbands and children, thank your wife and mom for all of the visible and invisible labor that they do for your family. And not just once a year on Mother's Day, show appreciation every day. What does the Bible say about rest and taking care of yourself? For I will satisfy the weary soul, and every languishing soul I will replenish. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. He restores my soul. God wants you to replenish your weary souls, to have rest. So show gentleness on yourself as you do all of the visible and invisible work. Allow yourself that self-care time. If you don't, you can get burned out and sick from doing everything for everyone else, and your best self will suffer. The foundation of our roles as mothers, of our roles as anything, as daughter, spouse, sister, friend, employee, or volunteer, is our personal relationship with Jesus. This is the fruit of the spirit of faithfulness, our personal connection to God. He is our rock, our strength, our salvation, in whom we can do all things. And it is only through him we can do all of these roles, the multitude of them, all at the same time, with the burden and joys of each piled up on our shoulders. Great is his faithfulness to us, to give us the strength to do it all. So we need to be faithful to him. Spend that daily time with him to build a relationship, to read his word, so his promises come to mind the moment we need them. A few of the promises I keep dear to encourage and motivate me are Joshua 1:19, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. The battle is not yours, but God's. All things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. God is with her. She will not fall. And my ultimate favorite, Isaiah 40, verse 31. Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. There's a song by one of my favorite Christian artists, Lauren Daigle, called My Revival, which lyrics include this promise. I will run and not grow weary. I will walk. I will not faint. I will soar on wings like eagles. Find my rest in your everlasting name. You are my revival. Jesus, on you I wait. I'll lean on your promise. You will renew my strength. I play this song whenever I am feeling tired and I need to revive my godly strength, which only comes from above. The fruit of the spirit of goodness to me means being a positive influence. Because of the many roles we play in life and the various platforms or stages we perform on, whether at home, work, or social, we need to be mindful of the influence we may have on others. And that influence should be positive, not negative. As women and mothers, we are leaders in our homes to our children, at church, at work. We must lead by example. Positive, inspiring, and empowering example, because people are watching. Our kids first and foremost, our spouses, our family, peers, and co-workers. Like Matthew 5 verse 16 says, we as Christians should be a light for all to see, showing good in our actions and speech wherever we can. Ephesians 4 verse 29 says, "Let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them." Instead of using bad language, we should say good and helpful words so that we can encourage people, not bring them down. No passive-aggressive comments, no sarcasm, and no nonverbal negative vibes or looks. If you can't, then use the wise old advice. If you can't say anything nice, don't say anything at all. But if you can say something nice, please do. Folks will be encouraged by your kind words. My family and I watched a devotional about this in the Bible app the other day. I cringed because I knew God was directing the message at me since I had lost my temper the other night. And I lashed out at my kids, saying some really bad things. The devotional reminded me that I can be so encouraging to my colleagues at work, but I can have a really bad attitude and say some mean things at home to my kids. But being a good influence, a good leader, and good example all start at home with my kids, my husband, and my parents. When I was in Wilfrid Laurier at university, many, many years ago, I wanted so badly to be a cheerleader. I loved acrobatics and I wanted to do flips and be on top of the pyramid. So I tried out and I would have made the team, but realized that all of the sports games were going to be on Saturdays. And so I sadly withdrew since I didn't want to break the Sabbath. I was so disappointed. I remember meeting a girl in my dorm room, a virtual stranger, and she saw that I was upset and she asked me what was wrong. I told her what had happened and that I really, really wanted to be a cheerleader. And you know what she said to me? She said, "Sometimes there are just more important things." Seven words, and it turned my whole day around. Yes, virtual stranger, Sabbath is more important than cheerleading. I can be a cheerleader in heaven. This experience reminding me of Proverbs 25:11. "A word fitly spoken is like apples of gold in a setting of silver." The New Living Translation reads, "Timely advice is lovely, like golden apples in a silver basket." Apples of gold. That's what I want us to share with others. Good and kind words of encouragement. The fruit of the spirit of kindness, to me, means empathy. What is empathy? Empathy is the capacity to understand or feel what another person is experiencing from their point of view. It's putting yourself in their shoes, trying to see their perspective and feel their feelings. It's like when my child tells me, "I'm sad." "Why, child?" "Because it's Sunday night and the weekend is over and school starts again tomorrow." Instead of me saying, "That's life, child. Expect it every 7 days for the rest of your life. Get used to it." And yes, I have said that. Empathetic mommy Meredith should say, "I feel the same way, son. We had such a nice and restful weekend, and it's sad that it's ending, so it's normal to feel blue. But you know what? You're going to see your friends and your teachers and learn a lot of great things tomorrow at school. Then in a few days, it'll be the weekend again. What is the difference between sympathy versus empathy? Like this image shows, sympathy is telling your friend everything will be okay. But empathy is telling your friend that everything will be okay, but also crying with her. You are feeling and experiencing her sadness with her. What does the Bible say about empathy? Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. Jesus is the ultimate example of kindness, the ultimate empathizer. Look what he did for the woman at the well. He identified with her, talked about her various abusive husbands. So he was empathizing with her. He knew she had experienced abuse. He didn't have to acknowledge that, but he did. And by doing that, he was walking alongside her in her pain. That's empathy. How do we communicate empathy to our children and therefore teach them to be empathetic? The Gottman Institute suggests that we can say things like, "I'd feel the same way you do in your situation. That would scare me too. I would have been disappointed by that too. That would hurt my feelings too." Right now in the pandemic, people are feeling alone, isolated, and lonely. That's one of the worst feelings. If you don't think anyone feels the way you're feeling or can understand the pain that you're in, it can be very emotionally taxing and draining. I have three kids, and I had postpartum depression. I attended a therapy group with other moms who were going through the same thing. It helped tremendously to hear that I was not alone in my struggles, in my thoughts, in my challenges. I heard other moms' stories, which helped normalize my own experiences. And it was a blessing that helped lift me out of my depression, knowing that I was not alone and other moms felt the same or worse. I was surrounded by empathy. Let kindness, empathy, and compassion drive us to be better human beings. An abundance of the patience fruit of the Spirit is needed for parenting. I know, I have three kids. I need patience not to get annoyed or angry, patience to not get frustrated when my child needs me, but I have competing priorities like work or elderly care. Patience for how long it takes my kids to obey. Regular parenting requires an abundance of patience, but pandemic parenting, wowzers, that's next level. Check out the many demands on a woman at home these days as she parents during the pandemic. Laundry, cleaning, cooking, feeding, minding children, working, running the home and school schedules, plus all of that invisible mental load. Then building in time for spiritual life and self-care. My husband and I have been working remotely now for over a year. Our kids have been in and out of physical school or daycare. They are now our co-workers, and we are sharing our office space with colleagues who are playing Lego or watching Netflix or constantly interrupting our work to ask for snacks or because they're bored. How do we manage working from home, living at work, and teaching at home? Deep breaths, counting to 10, setting boundaries, taking turns, and sharing the load. I could not manage pandemic parenting without my husband and the support of my own parents. I am blessed with a marriage partnership where we are both active in our children's lives and care. I recognize that some women feel the disproportionate impact of the pandemic stresses more than their spouses, with the women bearing the brunt of taking care of the kids at home while also working. And I recognize that two parents of multiple children is challenging enough. So kudos and blessings to the single parents who are taking care of it all on their own. God bless. What does the Bible say about patience? Love is patient. That's what I've taught my kids to tell me, to tell their dad, and each other whenever they get impatient with each other. Love is patient, Mommy. It's quick to diffuse my impatience. James 1:19. Be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger. We have two ears and one mouth, so we should be listening two times more than we speak. And practice patience and self-control so we don't lash out in anger. As a mother of three kids who works a lot, and especially during the pandemic, I feel guilt. Guilt for working full-time and not being as present with my kids as I'd like to be. Guilt during the pandemic for being an even worse mom because my plate overfloweth and I have zero bandwidth. The fruit of the spirit of peace to me is releasing this guilt. In her book, Forget Having It All, Amy Westervelt summarizes the working mom dilemma. We expect women to work like they don't have kids and raise kids as if they don't work. To me, this is an impossible standard to be measured by. And when we inevitably fall short, women feel guilty. That working mom guilt. It feels like a no-win situation, and it fuels feelings of overwhelm, exhaustion, and defeat, and can lead to burnout. What can we do? Be present with our kids. When you do spend time together, don't be distracted. Put your phone away. Don't talk or think about work. Overwhelm them with love and attention and kisses and cuddles if they want them. We cannot be perfect, but we can try. This infographic really resonated with me. It talks about COVID-19 mom guilt, and you may be feeling like this mama. I'm too exhausted to cook healthy meals. I'm not spending enough time with my kids. I don't have enough time for my spouse. I'm yelling at my kids way too often. I'm not working hard enough at my job. My kids have too much screen time. Yes, I've felt all of these things many times during the pandemic. What can we do? You can remember that you are not a bad mother, and we are not failing our kids. Release that guilt. Let it go. If you don't, it can become a heavy burden that we might not be able to get out from under. Forgive yourself. Your kids will forgive you. God will forgive you. So why can't we forgive ourselves? We can remember Isaiah 26:3. You will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you, all those whose thoughts are fixed on you. If we trust in God and allow Him to take the burden of guilt, He will keep us in perfect peace. What keeps me up at night? Worrying about my kids. What will their future be like if I don't shape it and them now? What if I'm not doing enough? What if I'm doing too much and I'm a helicopter parent? And what if they don't know how to be independent? Will they sink or swim? And the pandemic has made our anxieties worse. Are our kids going to make it through this pandemic without physical and limited social interaction? Will our kids' mental health or academic success be impacted? The fruit of the Spirit to me means releasing anxiety and fear. We need to stop being overwhelmed with worry, fear, and anxiety. Turn our anxiety into prayer. Pour over our worries and fears, our children, with prayer. There is amazing power in a praying parent. Other points of worry and anxiety may keep you up at night. You may literally not be sleeping because of it. We are anxious about health, finances, employment, and broken relationships. We are fearful of catching COVID, losing our jobs, losing our loved ones. We are mourning missed celebrations, graduations, weddings, and social gatherings because of the lockdowns. These Bible promises speak to those fears and anxieties. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. We need not fear, because God Almighty is with us. Cast all your anxiety on Him because He cares for you. I sang that song to all of my babies. I cast all my cares upon you. I lay all of my burdens down at your feet. And anytime I don't know what to do, I will cast all my cares upon you. Philippians 4 verse 6, be anxious for nothing, or don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything and be thankful. Then what? The peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. I love that. He's not saying he's going to grant us everything that we pray for, but that he will give us peace so we can sleep, so we can release the guilt, the anxiety, the worry, the fear, so we no longer carry that burden. And when we release the guilt, anxiety, and fear, we make room in our hearts for joy. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. My lips will shout for joy when I sing praise to you. Listening to praise and worship music helps me feel joyful and rejoice in the Lord. Another song I like to listen to is called Even When It Hurts, I'll Praise You by Hillsong United. Even when my strength is lost, I'll praise you. Even when I have no song, I'll praise you. Even when it's hard to find the words, louder then, I'll sing your praise. I will only sing your praise. Let's release the anxiety and fear to the Lord and find his joy. The last fruit of the Spirit, which is really the first and foremost, is love. But the greatest of these is love. Above all else, love each other deeply. In Matthew 22:37-39, Jesus said that the first and greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. The New International Version reads, love always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. All of the fruit of the Spirit, a mother's fruits, start with love. Love of those who depend on us motivates us to be physically and mentally well, healthy. So we use self-control and discipline to exercise and eat well. God's love for us draws him. God's love for us draws us to him and motivates us to be faithful and connected to him to gain heavenly strength to fulfill the various roles we have as mothers and women. Love and respect for ourselves motivates us to show gentleness to ourselves and to make time for self-care and rest. Love for those around us motivates us to show goodness and be a positive influence to our neighbors, as Jesus calls them. Love for others motivates us to let kindness and empathy drive our interactions. Because we love our children and family, we are motivated to be patient and not short-tempered with them. Because God loves us, we can seek peace by giving him our burdens and releasing the guilt of not being able to do it all, especially during these pandemic times. Because God loves us, we can release our fears and anxieties to Him and make room for joy and rejoicing. As 1 Corinthians 16:14 reads, "Let all that you do be done with love." Put on or wear love wherever you go. And why should we love? Because God loved us first. And we are a reflection of God's love unto others. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your gifts of the fruit of the Spirit. Help us to use it as a guide to love others and ourselves and to sow the seed of love so it can bear the other fruits of joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. Lord, we have so much going on right now with the many roles that we play on this earth, and yet we want to be perfect in you. But all we can do is try. So I ask for your strength to try our best. Try to be physically and mentally well. Try to stay connected to you, Father God. Try to make time for self-care and rest. Try to be a positive influence. Try to let empathy drive our interaction. Try to parent with patience. Try to release the guilt and gain peace. Try to release anxiety and gain joy. And try to lead all of this with love. Help us to claim the promise. We can do all things through Christ who gives us strength. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.